It's fairly large. There are bigger ones, but it's a nice big number. Yep. And it's a particular number. It's a number I've had some association with, might you say. This number is 129 decimal digits long, so it's probably more than your calculator can handle easily, although maybe these days calculators are getting pretty smart. But it's something a computer could work with easily, and in fact computers have, and might have good reasons to work with them. This number has a history that goes back to the late 70s. We created this number as a challenge. I don't remember the number, I haven't memorized it. So if you'd like, I can read you a few of the digits. So 114-381-625-757-8888, that's four eights in a row, 6766-923-577-99-761-466. 120-102-182-9, and that's the first line.
How does it end?
And it goes on for a while, and then it ends 8795435541. So 129 digits altogether. We didn't read them all, but I can. They're posted on my website if you want to see them. It'll be in the description of the video. And this number has a name as well, so it's got a much shorter name than the number itself. It's sometimes called RSA-129 because it has 129 digits. So RSA, those are the initials of three of us that worked on an interesting cryptographic system back in the 70s. R is my first initial of my last name. S is for Adi Shamir, and A is for Len Edelman. And the three of us invented a particular cryptographic system that's based on big numbers like the one you just heard. So where did this number come from? This number we created as part of an experiment, a challenge, to find out more about the security of the cryptographic scheme that we proposed. The scheme that we proposed was based on products of large prime numbers. So this number has an interesting property. It's the product of a large prime number P and another large prime number Q. And you multiply those two prime numbers together and you get this number RSA-129. So that's how it was created, and we created it secretly choosing P, secretly choosing Q. In fact, we forgot how we created P and how we created Q. Nobody should have known, not even us actually, after the number was created, what those numbers P and Q were. They were multiplied together. They're uniquely determined by the product. There's only one P and one Q that multiply together to give this number. But the security of the cryptographic scheme that we proposed depends on assumptions like that, that nobody should be able to find out a P and a Q from their product, P times Q.
Who generated the number? It was you, wasn't it?
Yes, Adi and Len and I did that. We generated the number, we rolled some dice, we generated some random numbers, and we multiplied, found some prime numbers that were near the initial numbers we generated, and then multiplied them together. So we generated them. Maybe in my subconscious somewhere it's there, but I doubt it.
But you didn't write them down on a scrap of paper?
We didn't write them down, no. So,
why not? Why didn't you keep them in a safe or something so you knew the answer to the puzzle?
Well, if the puzzle gets solved, then we will find out the P and the Q. And if the puzzle didn't get solved, well, that's fine. Why risk having it get stolen or something if somebody broke into my wallet or wherever I would keep those numbers? Finding a prime number is not that hard, actually. I mean, you just need to find big numbers, and finding big numbers isn't that hard. Big random numbers aren't so hard. You can roll some dice use other methods. And so we take some big random numbers, and then you can see, is that number prime? Well, maybe not. Maybe it's even, so it's obviously not prime. So maybe you can add one to it and see if that number is prime. And there's an easy test for primality, which I don't need to go into here, but it's easy to test if a number is prime. And so you can just search a little bit, and primes are actually quite common, so it doesn't take much time to find a large prime number. And then you've got your number P. And you can do the same thing, start it with a different starting point to find your number Q. And you've got a big prime number P, a big prime number Q. RSA was a response to an open problem posted by Diffie and Hellman. Diffie and Hellman had this idea that you could have a way of doing cryptography called public key cryptography, where you could tell somebody how to encrypt without telling them how to decrypt. So the idea of RSA is that the core difficulty that you give an adversary is the product of factoring a large number in. So you might choose two large prime numbers, multiply them together, and post that as your public key. So if I'm sending a message to you using your public key, and you've got posted as your public key the product of two prime factors, you do yourself need to know those two prime factors in order to do the decryption effectively. So you keep those secret. That's your secret key. You don't tell anybody. You need those to decrypt. In the case of this challenge, we weren't decrypting messages sent to us with that, so we didn't need to record the factors. But in practice with RSA, you'll need to have one party who knows the prime factors and everybody else who knows just the public key, the product of those two prime factors. We came up with the idea, and it seemed to work. It seemed to have the right kind of properties. It gave the ability to post a public key in such a way that nobody could figure out how to decrypt something that was encrypted with that public key. But there's a missing piece then and still now to some extent. We don't really know how hard factoring the products of two large prime numbers is. And so we set out a challenge, and that was the first challenge. Well, actually, there was many more challenges later, a whole ladder and sequence of challenges, but RSA 129 was the first one. And we said, you know, this we think is a hard problem. We don't think you'll be able to solve that. We put an estimate in a column, actually, that Martin Gardner wrote about this, estimating that it would take 40 quadrillion years to factor this particular product, RSA 129. And we offered $100 to anybody who could do it. And the goal there was just to learn about the difficulty of factoring. If somebody could factor it, we say, well, you're off, Rivest and Shamir Nadelman, as to how hard factoring is. Maybe it's easier than you thought. So we offered the $100 prize. So at the time, it was an open problem, and still is an open problem as to how hard it is. It was poorly studied at the time. There were some papers published, not like now. After RSA, then factoring has become an object of much more studying. But before then, it was more of a curiosity, and a few people studied it. And so we had to search around to find people who had thought about factoring. But it seemed to be hard. There were no good algorithms. It's also the case that RSA is flexible in the sense that you can choose prime numbers of any length and build an RSA modulus that way. So you can build numbers of products of 250-digit primes or 200-digit primes or 200-digit primes or whatever you like. So you can make it much more challenging for the adversary by choosing the primes larger. So it seemed like factoring would be a good foundation. And the question really is, how big should the primes be chosen? So with RSA 129, it sat there for quite a while. I mean, we had that number was published in the late 70s. During the 80s, not much happened. Computers started getting faster. The internet started happening. In the early 90s, the web happened. But that number was just sitting there and seemingly ignored for a long time. But then in 94, a team of researchers came up with the factorization. And they used the increases in computer speed to factor the number. They used the internet to get a team of people all over the planet to factor the number. They used better algorithms to factor the number. And after a lot of work, they were able to produce the two prime factors that, when multiplied together, gave RSA 129. And that was quite a shock to us.
Was it? I mean, if everyone's working on the one specific case, I would have thought maybe it would be easier to crack if all the people were looking at the one number.
You can sort of predict the growth of technology. So the speed of computers you can predict, the number of computers you can get together to work on a problem you can predict pretty well. What you don't know how to predict so well is the improvement in algorithms, and that's really what the key was here, was better algorithms.
Did this undermine anything, where had cryptography gone since then?
Cryptography had evolved tremendously since then. It was a surprise to us. It didn't mean that RSA was in any way disabled or dead. It just meant that numbers of that size shouldn't be used. Those numbers were too short. The primes were too short. And that was the lesson there. And that was one of the things we wanted to learn from this challenge was, is that a reasonable size to use, or do you need to use larger numbers? People still use RSA. They just use larger numbers than this now. So instead of a 129-digit number, they might use a 200-decimal-digit number or a 300-digit number, say. So larger numbers seem to be immune from these kinds of attacks still. So we had offered $100 for the factoring of this, and so we had to pay up, and we did. So we wrote a cashier's check for $100 and gave it to the team. Derek Atkins, Michael Graff, Arian Lenstra, Paul Leyland were the team that led to this. Many other people were involved as well. And so we wrote a $100 cashier's check for them. At the time, I thought it was probably, and maybe still is, the cheapest purchase of lots and lots of computer time ever. So it really, $100 for that much computing time was really quite a coup, I thought.
Mr. R in RSA, yeah. Feel about quantum computing.
So quantum computing seems to be coming along. People keep working on it. There's quite a bit of money involved in the research side of things. I would love to see it fall flat on its face and not work at all. It would be the demise of RSA should quantum computing happen.
Let's say you're the bank and you give out two numbers. They're public, so everyone can know them. They're not secret numbers. I'm going to choose the number 3 and the number 10. The bank also has a secret number.